A shop in Portland, Oregon, recently featured a display of paintings of nearby Mount St. Helens. One of them, showing the mountain in violent eruption, bore this caption: "Now that I have your attention, is it possible that someone has been trying to get this planet to look his way?" It is written. This is George Vandeman. Today, It Is Written presents A Planet Out to Lunch. It's the story of a hero of the Chinese rice fields. Lafcadio O'Hearn tells it, and it happened during an earthquake. From his hilltop farm, this unnamed hero saw the ocean swiftly pull back like some ferocious animal crouching for the leap. And he knew the leap would be a tidal wave. He saw, too, that his neighbors working in the fields below must somehow be brought to his hill and fast, or be swept away. How could he get their attention? His own rice had already been harvested. There it was, still in the husks, the cut plants piled in huge stacks, practically his total food supply. But he knew what he would do. Without a moment's hesitation, he set fire to the stacks of rice and furiously rang the temple bell. His neighbors thought his farm was on fire and rushed to help him. It was then from his safe hill that they looked down and saw the water swirling around the fields that they just left, realized how much their rescue had cost. Is it possible that God, from his high eternity, can see the tidal wave of destruction that is crouched for the leap, ready to rush in and sweep us away? We're a generation preoccupied in the low fields, in the marketplace, the casinos of pleasure. We're not listening. We're looking the other way. We're tuned to another channel. We have other things on our mind. We have the receiver off the hook. We're a generation out to lunch. If there's a God, and if he's trying to get our attention, how might we expect him to go about it? Will he set the sky ablaze and ring a bell wildly and get us to look his way? Will he step out on a cloud and take a giant microphone in his hand and let the sound of his voice rumble throughout the planet? You see, God tried something like that once. He came down personally to this earth and stood atop Mount Sinai. The mountain smoked and quaked at his presence. And with his own voice, he spoke the Ten Commandments, his moral code for all men. But how did the people react? Listen, we have an eyewitness report. Right over here in Exodus 20, listen to this. Exodus 20, verses 18 and 19. Notice what it says. Exodus 20, 18 and 19. When the people saw the thunder and the lightning, and heard the trumpet, and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses, "Speak to us yourself, and we will listen. But do not have God speak to us, or we will die." Scared out of their wits. Well, wouldn't you be too? So God didn't speak directly to his people anymore. He sent messages through the prophets, and occasionally by means of angels. But the people mistreated the prophets, and sometimes killed them, and the angels, fortunately, were not within their power. So finally, the Son of God came to live among us, to show us what God is like. He climbed upon a despised Roman cross and let men take his life to show us how far love would go to save us. But the cross is not much in the thoughts of this generation, this sophisticated generation. We have other things on our minds. Now, of course, we have a book that claims to be and evidently is the inspired Word of God. But most people don't bother to read it. It's considered by the sophisticated mind to be outdated, irrelevant, just a collection of myths and legends of no concern to us. And so we watch the 6 o'clock news and let it give us the jitters. We spend millions trying to find the answers somewhere out in space. And all the while, the book with the answers, the only answers, the most relevant book we could read, gathers dust on many a shelf. So what has God to do? How can it get our attention? Time is running out. The final page of this planet's berserk history is about to turn disaster. I say is crouched like a ferocious animal, ready to spring, just like a killer wave ready to sweep us to destruction. How can God get us to look his way? In the fall of 1980, God tried fire. But the epidemic of close calls began in August when a bomb was planted in Harvey's Resort Hotel at State Line, Nevada. The sophisticated device went off as bomb squads were trying to disarm it by remote control. And the explosion left a two-story hole in that Tahoe casino. Within minutes, people were back at their games of chance. In the days that followed, hundreds of similar extortion and bomb threats were received by hotel casinos. And then in November, fire swept through the huge and lavish MGM Grand Hotel in Las Vegas. More than 8,000 guests and employees of the hotel had to flee for their lives through clouds of choking smoke and deadly fumes. Some didn't make it. At least 85 were killed and more than 500 injured. 10 gamblers who ignored the cries of warning in the casino were incinerated by a sudden fireball that swept through that gilded room. 3 days after the MGM fire, a blaze in Harrah's in Reno forced hundreds to flee the towering hotel. And then in February, after a little respite, fire swept through the giant Las Vegas Hilton. Horror reigned again. 8 lives were lost and more than 200 were injured. Said the Associated Press, America's gambling playground is on a losing streak. Is that all it was? Just a losing streak? Or was God trying to get us to look his way? It isn't just fire. It's disaster of every kind. It's fire and flood and earthquake and avalanche and tornado. Something new in the experience of most of us, a real, live, active, erupting volcano. Listen, friend, disaster seems to have gone berserk. It's lost its sense of timing. It seems not to know when enough is enough. It's not courteous enough to ask if we can take any more. It has no qualms at all about following one calamity with a worse one the next day. Tragedies seem to be dumped on our heads in bunches. Is God trying to tell us something? True, it makes us stop and think. But not for long. We're a race of gamblers, friend. We gamble the disaster won't strike twice. And anyway, it won't happen to us, you see. Always happen to somebody else. We gamble with earthquakes by building directly over known earthquake faults. We gamble with fire by ignoring safety codes. We gamble with mudslides by building where a big rain can tumble us down the hillside. We gamble with fire and flood by building in canyons that may be directly in their path. And yes, a group of scientists even gambled with smoking Mount St. Helens by helicoptering into its crater. When they took off, they were sucked back down by a vertical wind. They crashed on the rim of the crater. We were gambling with nature, with the laws of physics, with arsonists, with the evil hearts of men. And neither evil men nor nature has any intention of playing it our way. But you say, Pastor Vandeman, nature is not evil. True, but nature too has felt the curse of sin. And I'm convinced that nature too is being manipulated by evil, at least so far as God permits. What do I mean? Listen, would you let me read something very interesting? Something to really think about. Listen. Satan delights in war, for it excites the worst passions of the soul. then sweeps into eternity, its victim steeped in vice and blood. Satan works through the elements, also to gather his harvest of unprepared souls. He has studied the secrets of the laboratories of nature, and he uses all his power to control the elements as far as God allows. Now, is that a new thought to you? Satan, the enemy of God, studying the secrets of the laboratories of nature, controlling the elements as far as God allows? But what would you expect of a ruthless enemy out to destroy all he can? And of course, remember, with the intelligence of a fallen angel, once the highest of all angels, wouldn't you expect him to be an excellent student? But listen, let me read on. While appearing to the children of men as a great physician who can heal all of their maladies, he, Satan, you see, will bring disease and disaster until populous cities are reduced to ruin and desolation. Even now he is at work in accidents and calamities by sea and by land, in great conflagrations, in fierce tornadoes and terrific hailstorms, in tempests, floods, cyclones, tidal waves and earthquakes. In every place and in a thousand forms, Satan is exercising his power. He sweeps away the ripening harvest, and famine and distress follow. He imparts to the air a deadly taint, and thousands perish by the pestilence. These visitations are to become more and more frequent and disastrous. Right to the point, wouldn't you say? Shockingly accurate, yet these are the words of Ellen G. White, written almost a century ago. An inspired prediction or just a good guess? You decide. So often God is blamed for disaster. But Satan, not God, is the destroyer. It is he, not God, who delights in destruction. God only permits it. Yet we're moving now into a time when God, more and more often, is permitting Satan to have his way. Why? Let me read it to you in Genesis 6, verse 3. Here in Genesis 6, verse 3, I read a very frightening word concerning the time of Noah, to be sure, but applicable today. Look, and the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man. As I say, these words were spoken specifically of Noah's day, but they apply with equal force today. For once again, just as in Noah's generation, God's spirit is being withdrawn from the earth. His protection is being lifted, and the destroyer permitted, you see, to work. We're again approaching a time when the judgments of God will be released upon a generation that has almost completely rejected his creator. God will permit these judgments to fall, or even initiate them, not because he does not love us, but because he does. He's trying to get our attention. He's permitting or even sending the smaller judgments because he wants so desperately to spare us from the greater judgments that are about to fall. Could a God of love do otherwise? Is it easier now to understand the epidemic of casino fires, high-rise fires, fires that we have been assured couldn't happen? Men may tell us that these buildings are perfectly safe, but one touch of God's hand will sweep them away, or his permission with Satan's hand, they'll be consumed as if made by pitch. Balls of fire will not only be confined to skyscrapers, according to the Word of God, and gambling casinos, they'll fall among the most expensive homes. Large portions of our great cities will be destroyed. For God is trying to warn us of the destruction that will soon come upon the whole earth. And when it happens, many will be surprised. They will say, we knew that the judgments of God were coming on the earth, but we didn't know it would be so soon. And others will respond bitterly, you knew, then why didn't you tell us? I don't ever want one of you to say that to me. That's why I'm sharing these things today. These things will happen. In fact, the book of Revelation tells us plainly, here in Revelation 16, verse 19. And the cities of the nations fell. This isn't the first time that this planet has approached judgment. In Noah's day, as in ours, a generation had turned its back on God. It wanted nothing to do with him. In effect, it had hung a sign on its closed door, out to lunch. And God, knowing all things, might well have written beneath it, "We'll return too late." Now, this is what Jesus said, speaking of Noah's day and ours, over here in Matthew 24, 37 to 39. Here we find in the second coming chapter, the chapter that's all about the second coming of Jesus, these descriptive words. Look, as it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. Surprised? And they didn't need to be. God had been trying to get their attention for 120 years. Well, that's the way it'll be in our day. That's the way it is. The sun still shines. Men are still buying and selling, jostling one another for the highest place, marrying and divorcing, eating and drinking. Not necessarily wicked, just too busy, just out to lunch, not listening to God's storm warning. But the storm is approaching with a speed that would take our breath away if we knew. The Savior has long been knocking at the door of our hearts. We've ignored his knock. We've not bothered to read his mail. We've forgotten his warnings. We've made light of his rules. What could he do but let a few volcanoes erupt, a few fires burn, a few disasters overtake us? The question is this: how many disasters will it take to get our attention? How far gone is our hearing? How dim has our eyesight become? How forgetful are we when we want to be? What will it take to get you to look his way? The sound that you hear in your heart just now is the sound of Jesus knocking for entrance. He's waiting, hoping that you'll let him in. Listen to this.
Time after time, I went searching for peace in some void. I was trying to blame all my ills on this world we are in. Surface relationships used me again and again. And all the while someone was waiting to free me from sin. He was there all the time. He was there. Never again will I look for a fake rainbow's end. Now that I have the answer, my life is just starting to rhyme. Sharing each new day with him is a cup of fresh life. Oh, what I missed. He's been waiting right there all the time. He was there all the time. He was there.
Thank you, Ben Parrish. Shall we pray? Father mine, you have our attention. We want you to keep it. Too long we fail to look your way. And just now, while you wait, we respond, favorably respond. I ask this for every viewer. Save us, please, dear Lord, in spite of ourselves, in Jesus' priceless name, his saving name, amen.
Hello, I'm Roland Lenhoff. In a moment, our prayer alert feature for today. Yes, as Ben's saying, he is there all the time, and will soon return to claim those who will open their hearts to him. And that's why Pastor Vandeman's book, The Day the Cat Jumped, is the book that we're offering today. The Day the Cat Jumped is a book about the future, about the second coming of Christ, and there may be some surprises. We'll tell you in a moment how to request your personal copy. If you care about the future, if you care about your destiny, you need this book. It could keep you from being fatally deceived. Don't let anything keep you from getting your copy. Ask for it by name, The Day the Cat Jumped, so that we'll send you the right book. And now here is the information you need.
You may request Pastor Vandeman's free offer by writing directly to George Vandeman, Thousand Oaks, California, 91360. The offer is sent by mail free and postpaid. Our address is easy to remember. Just George Vandeman, Thousand Oaks, California, and the zip is 91360. Please be sure to ask for the offer by name, and we'll put it into the mail right away. It takes only a few moments to write, but it could mean a lifetime of satisfaction. While you're writing down the address, let me remind you to invite a friend to watch It Is Written with you next week at this same time on this station. Thank you for your letters, your prayer requests, and your liberal support, which is so necessary in a television ministry like It Is Written. The address again is George Vandeman, Thousand Oaks, California, and the zip is 91360.
Friend, it's important to me that you request today's gift offer, The Day the Cat Jumped, so that you might prayerfully study our subject more fully. And my prayers are with you as you deepen your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. But now it's time for our prayer alert feature for today.
We're in the studios of radio station KSGN, located on the La Sierra campus of Loma Linda University. In a moment, station manager Lee McIntyre is going to tell us how God worked a miracle to keep this station on the air. That's today on Prayer Alert.
Joining hands across the miles, It Is Written's Family of Prayer and Circle of Caring. Prayer Alert.
KSGN. These are the call letters for this radio station. Lee, could you tell us what they stand for?
KSGN at 90 FM stands for Keep Sharing the Good News.
So this is a station that broadcasts religious music and messages from the Word of God. Is that right?
That's right.
Now, all of us remember a short time ago when everyone was experiencing the tension-filled days because of a series of fires which swept through Southern California, destroying hundreds of homes and other property. I understand, Lee, that this was also a time when this radio station was in serious danger. Is that right?
That's right. We went off the air that morning when the fires burned down the electrical power lines, taking power to our transmitter in the San Bernardino Mountains, about 25 miles from where we're sitting right now. That morning, as we looked out the window of our studio and saw the smoke and flame in the air, even from 25 miles away, we were afraid. Each of us here on the staff, Bruce Potterton, our operations manager, Todd Zervis, the computer director, Betty Gonzalez, the secretary, each of us and I prayed in his own way, Lord, this is your station. You take care of it. There's nothing we can do. We left it up to him.
Now, what happened after that?
A miracle. When we went up to the transmitter site that night after the flames had completely burned over the area, we discovered that the flames had rushed up the mountain toward our transmitter site. But when they reached the building, the flames parted, went around the transmitter and tower, joined up again on the other side, and burned on down the mountain. But they didn't scorch a brick or damage the roof or even overheat a single electrical component.
Now, if that tower would have been destroyed, how long would you have been off the air?
The heat could have mangled that tower, and we would have been off the air for several months.
Well, it certainly is a miracle to see how God preserved that tower from those flames to keep the message of salvation going out through this station to the hearts of men. I'm sure that there are others of you who are watching today that have evidence of God working in your life, and you'd like to share this with us at It Is Written. Feel free to write to us this week. Others of you have specific requests for prayer that you would like to write to us about. Those who write this week are going to receive Pastor Vandeman's book, Unlocking Heaven's Storehouse. Write to George Vandeman, Thousand Oaks, California, 91360. Again, Pastor Vandeman.
And here's how you can benefit from and become a vital part of Prayer Alert. Simply send me your prayer request, whatever it may be, or just let me know you're joining us in prayer. Write to me, George Vandeman, Thousand Oaks, California, 91360. And I'll send you Unlocking Heaven's Storehouse. But now the time has come all too quickly to say goodbye, everyone. But remember, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.